This is your guide to book publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask, with your host, Dr. Judith Bryles. On the show today, you'll find out where book publishing is going and how to take advantage of it. How to identify and avoid publishing predators. What opportunities are emerging as the book trade evolves in new forms. How to avoid losing money, and much, much more. Join us now as a variety of publishing pros will deliver insights and strategies to take the author to the next level of publishing. It's your guide to book publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask. Brought to you by AuthorU and The Book Shepherd. And now, here's your host, Dr. Judith Bryles.
And welcome to another episode of AuthorU, Your Guide to Book Publishing. And I am so tickled to have Derek Doepker back with us for actually a standalone from what we did last week, which is the steps to his Aspire method for success for you as an author, as a writer, as a marketer. We're going to take it another step today, and we're going to go into emailing. And to me, it is the pot of gold. So as Derek and I go through this hour together, that remember that we're going to give you a lot of ahas. Please have your pencil and paper out, or pen and paper, whatever you use. Lots of insights and tips that will enhance and support your book publishing and book marketing journey. Remember, if you're on Twitter, make sure you follow me at My Book Shepherd, and Derek is at Author Secrets. We're also both on Facebook and a variety of other areas. And if you have any question, you can always email me at judith@bryles.com. I always love to start with a quote. I decided that was going to be one of the things I did this year. So out of my book, Snappy, Sassy, Salty, for authors and writers, here's it for today. Writers should start on their books before they are ready. Otherwise, they can spend their time getting ready in perpetuity. So many times I see authors, wannabe authors, people who say, yes, there's a book in them, but they practice what I call the art of one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, and they never truly go. Well, this also applies to our topic today, which is emails. The gathering of emails, the collection of emails, the growing, the necessity of getting more emails, because that is your marketing pot of gold. At least that's my opinion, Derek. You want to jump in?
Yeah, I'll jump in. And that quote does apply a lot to emails. The idea, and really success in general, is this idea of you get started before you maybe feel you're ready to get started. And it's never too soon to start gathering emails. And I also don't think it's ever too soon to begin emailing your list, even if that list is one person, two people, three people, whoever it is, because building that habit is the most important thing. And it's also great in terms of the contents of emails, because I like the early stages when maybe you don't have a big audience, because that's the time that you get to play, you get to practice, you get to develop your message and your style and not worry about, you know, tens of thousands of people seeing what you're doing. So it's actually an advantage when you're starting out to begin gathering these emails, begin the process of email marketing, even if you don't feel like you're totally ready for it yet.
Well, and then, you know, when you're doing that play area, the setup, it doesn't feel like marketing, although that's what you're doing. I mean, they don't think of it as marketing per se, or you shouldn't. You know, I don't let yourself get caught, because I've heard a gazillion times, Derek, I just want to write. I don't want to market. I don't want to do marketing. I mean, I wish we had a buck every time we've heard that.
Yeah, well, and the funny thing about that when it comes to emails is emails are writing. It's another opportunity for you to write. And there's just this kind of funny thing that happens. It even happens when writing a book or anything, where it's like sometimes a person goes into a different mode. And so I'll share a quick story, and this ties into emails. I remember reading someone was writing a little bit about kind of their journey, how they got to doing what they were doing. And it sounded, as some people sound when they first start writing, very academic, very formal. And I go, well, just tell me your story, you know, kind of what happened. And you're on a Zoom call recording it. And I go, great. Now take the recording that we just did of you sharing your story, transcribe that, and that's pretty much 80% done. And the moral of the story is they were able to communicate their story in a compelling way when they were just having a conversation with someone. But when they sat down to write it and go, oh, I'm in writer mode now, and this was someone who didn't really consider themselves a writer, all of a sudden their whole tone changed. Well, it's the same thing when it comes to emails. If you're sitting there going, I'm writing a marketing email, and someone doesn't feel totally comfortable with marketing, it kind of throws off the whole vibe. But if you can get yourself in a place of like, oh, I'm just writing to a friend, even if you have hundreds or thousands of people you're sending an email out to, one of the best ways to create a good tone, the style of the email, usually is best if it's going to sound just like you wrote it to one person who's a friend. And if you can have your ideal fan in mind, like, oh, I'm writing this to Jane, I'm writing this to Joseph, I'm writing this to Brianne. Like, if you can visualize one person that you're writing your message to, whether that's with email, social media, anything else, a lot of times it will be more compelling and more effective from a marketing perspective without it feeling like you're in some sort of marketer mode.
And that maybe will ease the pain for so many of them. I don't know what it is, but I love what you're saying about writing to one person, because I often tell people, Derek, that when I say, so tell me who, this also ties in with email, who are you emailing to? Who is your book for? And, you know, if you put down your laptop or pulled away from your desktop or whatever it is you're writing on, and directly across from you is that person. Who is it? And have a conversation with that person. Maybe you don't want other people around while you're having the conversation, but it does smooth path, I think, for you and getting into that transition. And it makes life a little easier. At least it has for me.
Yeah, it's something that I've heard from many of the top marketers and writers is the importance of writing to one person. Mentally, it's impossible for me to think I'm writing to, 45 to 65 year olds. Well, I can't visualize that, but I can visualize having a conversation with one person. And this also ties into email and marketing in general, in that if you're trying to appeal to everyone, you're often going to appeal to no one. So actually, by going narrow and focusing your approach to the ultimate niche is a single person. Funny enough, you can end up having more appeal without worrying about, oh, am I going to turn some people off? I'm glad if I turn some people off who aren't a good fit, because then they get off my email list and now I'm not paying for them to be a subscriber if they were never really going to be an ideal fan anyway.
I am so glad you said that, because I have had actually some people with big mailing lists don't want to email out too much because they're afraid they're going to unsubscribe. And I remember saying to her, I said, but you want to get rid of them. Number one, you are, you know, with these big lists, you're paying. You are paying for these people. And if they're no longer the right fit for you, why would you want to carry them along? It amazes me. You do want to raid your list every once in a while.
Yeah, and if you look at it not just as a list, a number of people in some abstract sense, you really appreciate that this is a relationship. These are other human beings on the other end. Then think in your everyday life, do you want to be in a relationship, whether that's a friendship, a business partnership, a romantic relationship? Do you want to be in any relationship with someone where you know that other person doesn't want to be in a relationship with you? To me, that doesn't feel good. As I've heard one of my mentors, Joel Bauer, say, like, you know, I don't want to – paraphrasing, you know, don't want to be in a marriage with someone who doesn't want to be in a marriage with you. So if you think of your audience in that similar terms, it's like you want the people who want to be in a relationship with you. If they're lukewarm about it, or if they don't want that relationship with you, then, you know, set them free, let them go find someone who can better serve them. And that frees up your focus to better serve the people who do appeal to you.
And so that's a plus. All right. So Derek, let's kind of set the stage for what we're going to go through today. What are some of our key points? Well, maybe we can just start on the first key point you want to get into. I think write to one person is probably number one. Is there anything else that we add on to that? Because we're about 2 minutes from our first break.
Yeah, so another mental mindset to get into, which is going to help everything that you do with email marketing, is to go beyond the identity of I'm an author. Of course, you are an author. It's fine to have that identity. If you only think of yourself as an author, it can limit what you come up with, which thinking it's only talking about your book or books. What if you adopt an identity of I'm an entertainer. I'm an educator. I'm a curator of great content. These are just a few examples. I'm a storyteller, right? These identities allow you, if you're a storyteller, now it's not just about promoting your book. You can tell funny stories that happen to you. You can share stories you've heard. We can get more coming up into the actual specific content ideas. But just adopting that mindset allows you to see a lot more opportunities for things you can share with your audience. And curator, for anyone who doesn't know that term, it's like you're gathering maybe helpful articles or stories or pieces of content or even other books that you recommend. And now all of a sudden, if you're a curator of great content, you don't just have to talk about your book. You might talk about other great books that you've read, other great stories that you've heard. I might share as a nonfiction person, I often share, hey, here's a great article I read. Here's a great podcast I listened to. Here's a cool video I watched, and maybe comment on it, right? And so now all of a sudden, you're sharing helpful things with your audience, whether that's entertainment or education or inspiration, and they're getting value from it. And it also can make your life easier because you're not always having to come up with something from scratch. You might just be gathering other things that are out there and being like, hey, here's a cool thing I found that you might enjoy. So adopting an identity that includes being an author or writer and yet transcends it through thinking of yourself as a storyteller, an entertainer, an educator, a motivator, whatever identity works for you, that will allow you to see more opportunities and things that you can share with your audience through your emails.
Which is just plain old smart. And I love to, when I hear something, I read something, I see even a poem, I've taken some lines from a poem and taken that and played with it. But I think it's it does give you, especially when you pull the content and sharing in an email, an article that you said, a podcast you heard, and you push that out in your email, and you know, you give them link to where it goes to. They go then. I think it makes you look smarter. But with that said, I'm going to have you come back and comment on that. We'll be right back.
This is your guide to book publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask. With your host, Dr. Judith Briles. And we'll be right back with more great information right after these.
Is there a book in you? Or another? AuthorU shows you how to create, develop, and publish your book without being hoodwinked. If you already have a book out, you will find a supportive and brainstorming community that is connected and creative, no matter where you live. AuthorU brings in national experts for its book camps and annual AuthorU extravaganza. It has regular meetings and delivers webinars for its members on timely topics. Through AuthorU's extensive network, members enjoy exclusive benefits, including significant discounts for a variety of services necessary to publishing. AuthorU is the premier authoring resource in the country, creating community, education, guidance, vision, and success for the serious author. If you want to create a book that has pizzazz, punch, and panache, AuthorU is for you. Timely author and publishing tips and articles are posted on its social media platforms, and it is free. Discover AuthorU, where authors go to become seriously successful. Join AuthorU today at AuthorU.org.
Welcome back to your guide to book publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask. If you want to write and publish a book, if you want to be successful as an author, your guide to book publishing, everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask, is for you. Stay tuned and you'll hear about statistics, scenarios, and strategies on what to do now to get you published. So let's get back to the show. And here again is your host, Dr. Judith Briles.
With me is Derek Doepker, and we're really talking about what we both feel is the pot of gold for you, and that is the growth and the nurturing of the emails that are out there. And some of you may have just a few. Derek, I always ask, and when I do how to create an Amazon bestseller workshop that I do over 4 weeks. One of the things that we always do on that first session is I want to know what all my bench lines are. So I do want to know how many emails they have, how many on all their other platforms. So I know what we're going to be working with when we do the push out. And I am always amazed of the number that have very few emails, very few. Why is that?
Well, I have a few things that I've heard working with authors over about the last decade. And one thing is some authors is just not a priority. And, you know, then why is that? Well, for me, when I got started, I actually considered writing a book. Unfortunately, I was trained enough in the world of marketing that to me, a book was primarily to build my email list because I saw the value of email. So one thing that can happen is if you just don't see the value in it and realize that the vast majority of sales are driven by email, then it could be one of those, oh yeah, I hear it. It's kind of like eat your vegetables. You know, a lot of telling people build their email lists, like eat your vegetables. Like, yeah, I know I should probably do that, whatever. And like, you know, then try to like get away with not doing it. Once you realize that the vast majority of sales online, whether it's for authors and books or other products and services are driven by email, I would hope that you know, really appreciating that will help motivate authors because you can – there are people who have a pretty big Twitter following and Twitter can be useful for things, but I've seen people with big Twitter followings tweet out about their book, not make many sales, much smaller size email list and drive a lot more sales through email. So I'm not going to get over the top with a bunch of different stats and stuff, but if anyone wants to do the research on the ROI of email, and it is number one consistently year after year. 10 years ago, people talk about emails dead. Nope, it's still here. And I think it's going to continue to be here for a long time. So email, it drives sales. So that's the big thing. It's just recognizing that this needs to be, for me, it is the number one priority out of everything I'm doing in marketing. Like what's your one metric that matters the most? It's email, partly the size, but also really the relationship you have with your list. So if you have 1,000 people who are diehard fans on your email list, that can be more lucrative than 10,000 people who are lukewarm and don't engage at all. So making it a priority. And then another big thing is just not knowing really kind of how to do email, the uncertainty. How do I get people on my list? What do I send to people? And also some personal projection. That's like some people are like, well, I don't really like getting emails myself. I saw someone comment on this in a forum, like, I don't like getting emails, so I don't really want to do email marketing myself, which is projecting your personal, one's own personal preferences onto what other people might like and respond to. So, I mean, I'm sure we'll touch upon all these things, but those are a couple of the big reasons, just not appreciating how impactful it can be and then not really knowing exactly how do you do this? How do you build the list and engage with people in a way that's entertaining and not just pure like buy my book type of emails that are fine on occasion but aren't really what we're talking about when it comes to really nurturing a relationship with your audience.
So now we're going back to the percentages that we hear so often. Is it, you know, 80-20, 90-10, whatever it is, like any posting that goes out, what percentage should be about things, articles, stories, ahas, insights, info, versus buy my book? Have you heard any latest data on that? Because I'm going to bring and tie it into email.
Yeah, there's different theories on that. To me, I don't get into the numbers as much until later on, and here's what I mean by that. There's like, well, how many emails should be, let's say, just a, you know, helpful article type of thing versus something that has a, you know, sales and marketing message. And to me, it's like I've seen people who do, you know, Ben Settle's a kind of a classic example in the email marketing world is someone who every email has some sort of offer. And every email is usually entertaining and engaging in some way. So people are willing to read every single email, even if there's an offer, because the contents of the email is like, whether you buy something or not, people enjoy the, you know, the right people for his audience. I'm not saying everyone, the right people will enjoy the emails, right? So to me, my first question is, what experience do you create for people? And this also ties into another question, how often should I email people? You know, what's the right frequency? How many words should an email be? All these things, they have some consideration. To me, my first thought, though, is If the emails are boring, then even once a month is too many. If the emails are engaging and helpful and entertaining, you can get by with, in some cases, there are people who do every day. And some people are like, oh, every day, that's so many emails. Well, what if you love the emails and you look forward to them and like you get an email that from someone who you love it and you can't wait for the next email, right? So to me, the first question is, what is the experience you want to create for people, which comes back to being entertaining, being a good storyteller, educating, inspiring people, whatever it is, or combination of factors, so that people look forward to your emails, they want to read them. Then how you build in the sales element or how frequently you do it or things like that, that's a later point of consideration. Because you can, let's say, get away with, so to speak, a lot more if your emails are helpful and engaging and what you're offering to people is something that they really want. You can do a lot more in those cases versus if it's just a generic, hey, my book is on sale, click here to buy it. That's fine, but you can't do that like over and over and over again without people being like, okay, it's the same email just promoting their thing. I might as well just unsubscribe because I've seen all this person has to offer.
And I think that's true. You know, when I'm a subscriber to Seth Godin's blog, and I get that. Actually, I look forward to that as an email every day. And I would say if you were going to talk percentages out of a month, sometimes in a month, there is no pitch for anything in a whole month. They're always short. I don't know if you're familiar with his. Sometimes there are four lines, but they're always insightful. You know, you're going back to your, is it storytelling? Is it information? Is it insightful? Is it something that kicked me in the butt? You know, what is it? And that it's something I really do look forward. I never could see myself unsubscribing from him. And when he does have a few of his offers come along, and I'll look it over, and sometimes I go buy it because he's given me so much in the other stuff.
Yeah, you built a relationship, and this comes back. I will touch a little bit on frequency. I like having, when possible, more frequent emails. If it's, you know, somewhat shorter daily emails, and I appreciate. I know that there's a novelist out there who's going, come on, that's a nonfiction thing. What are you going to say as a novelist? Well, I have strategies for that. But even if it's a weekly email or something like that, to me, my first thing is if it's every 6 months right now, getting it to every month is an improvement. So I'm not about perfection. I'm about progression, just doing more than what you're doing right now if you're not emailing at all. That said, just the human psychology factor, if I sign up for someone's email list and then I don't hear from them for the next month or two, I'm not going to even remember who they are when I get that next email. And that can actually increase the unsubscribes. So I remember I went into used to go to a Starbucks near me, and after, I don't know, a few weeks, maybe a month or a couple months of going in there, they started going, hey, Derek, good morning, Derek, every time I came in. And I noticed I kind of started to like the people working there, and we didn't like talk that much. But what happens is when you see someone every day, you naturally develop an affinity for them. And there's psychological research on this that shows that it's just the familiarity factor. You tend to like people that you see more often, assuming they don't do something to make you not like them. As long as they're pleasant people, you'll tend to grow more fond of people you see on a regular basis. What does it have to do with email? The more you're showing up in their inbox, within reason, not 87 emails a day, but if they see you enough, whether that's email or social media, and they kind of, you become top of mind for them, when they think of a book to buy in your genre, you want to be the author or one of the top authors that springs to mind, that they already have this liking factor. So when you talk about Seth Godin and you consistently get his emails and you kind of feel good, get a little dopamine hit every time you read his emails, that's connected to seeing the name Seth Godin, which creates a no like and a possibly trust factor. So then when he does make an offer, you're more compelled to buy it because you already have built that relationship just from, not only good content, but also just probably seeing his name consistently and having those positive associations.
Which I think is important. And, you know, you bring up the infrequency thing. I think people get in trouble with all the filters and the spam blockers. That if you're too infrequent, you may end up in the spam file. Do you know anything about that? Is there any, I'm just kind of thinking out loud here.
Yeah, spam factors are a consideration. If people get to know your emails and they look forward to them, then another benefit is if people really like your emails, if something does end up in spam, there can actually be a thing where people are looking for your emails. They're like, I didn't see Judith's email. Where's it at? And then they might check the spam, or they look for it because they actually want to get your emails. So that's one thing. Another, just I would hope it's obvious that you want to write compelling emails, but there are some practical considerations too. And another thing that can be done strategically is anything that creates engagement. So if you get a lot of people responding to your emails, that can also help make sure it doesn't go to spam, because you know the email service providers can see that people are replying to your emails, that they're engaging with them. And so, you know, coming up, we can talk a little bit about specific strategies to get people on your email list who are sending you responses, who are, you know, you might ask questions that people respond to. Here's a quick, I'll just go right into it, the next 30 seconds. I saw one fiction author who she had like a photo. It was from, it's kind of like a meme image from the show The Big Bang Theory, and it was like, capture this photo, and like the best caption would win some sort of prize, right? Okay. So now all of a sudden, think about that. That's creating engagement with people. It's entertainment. Like, you get to capture a photo, you know, maybe make a funny caption or whatever it is, and then now that's generating content from your audience. Now people are looking forward to getting the next email, which is going to have the winner in it. You're like, I wonder what people captioned for this photo. And so that's a great strategy for just doing something that's entertaining and getting people responding to the emails. So that further builds that relationship. And then it also practically helps with the spam filters, because they're seeing all these people engaging with their emails, which has a positive impact on your reputation.
You know, Derek, I saw a perfect example of a cartoon using exactly the format you were talking about, of adding the caption to it. And it had the pearly gates, and it had Putin and two other people sitting in the front row, and then a regular everyday couple behind it. And they're talking to each other. And the caption is, what are they saying? And the winner was something like, well, at least we won't have to be here long. At least the wait is long, something like that. But you know, you could take it current. You could pull it out of the news, something out of the news. I see magazines and newspapers do this all the time. All right. Well, more ideas on growing your email list with Derek Doepker. We'll be right back.
This is your guide to book publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask. With your host, Dr. Judith Briles. And we'll be right back with more great information right after these.
Discover the power of you and your book at the Judith Briles Unplugged events. Each summer, Judith Briles Book Marketing Unplugged unfolds over 3 intensive days working with just Judith. You get publishing strategies, author and book platforms, book marketing panache and pizzazz, and authoring tools to take you and your book to rock star success. In the fall and winter, Judith Briles Speaking Unplugged includes Judith as your coach and mentor during 2 powerful days. You will learn how to structure a speech, how to create openings and closings, how to find gigs that pay you and sell your books, and you will get one-on-one coaching. Go to thebookshepherd.com and click on the events tab to learn how to participate at the next Unplugged Workshop event.
Welcome back to your guide to book publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask. Coming up, you'll hear more about statistics, scenarios, and strategies on what to do now to get you published. So let's get back to the show. And here again is your host, Dr. Judith Briles.
All right, so we are talking the glory and the power of emails. And what Derek has said is, your email should create an experience of some sort that, you know, whether you're providing information whether you're just giving them a chuckle, you know, whatever it is, that they start looking forward to your emails. Derek, is there an open rate that people should achieve? I know in marketing, they do talk about open rates.
Yeah, this is another thing where it's got to be taken in context. So if you have once you have a larger list, you know, if you have 10 people on your email list, you could get, you know, 50% plus open rates. Well, you're probably not going to get 50% plus open rates once you have 10,000 people, and that's just going to be standard. So yeah, if you're looking at less than 10%, there's probably an issue. 15% is getting you know, kind of more of a good minimum type of rate to hit. And then once you're beyond that, then it kind of just depends, because like, let's say you send an email that's really targeted to a certain segment of your audience. If you're sending it to everyone, you might not get as much of an open rate, but it could be more targeted. So like, let's say I have a list of authors and I might say something, you know, for romance authors only or whatever. Like maybe there's something just for that. Well, that might not get as much open rate, but the people who open might be more, interested in that. So that's just one example. I would say that if you can look at, you know, 15% plus, that's good. Beyond that though, I'm much more about, are the people who they're really engaging? And if there's people who haven't opened in a long time, there's other strategies for, you know, cleaning up the list. And it's also a reason why I'm actually happy with unsubscribes, because I want the unengaged people off the list and actually improving the metrics by making sure the people sticking around are the people who open and engage.
Exactly. And I'm with you totally there. And also I have the same attitude about social media. You know, when people, whether it's an, I don't know what they call it. Facebook, is it unfriend? Is that what that is? I don't know what Instagram is. I know it's unsubscribed on Twitter and LinkedIn, but it's when they're the wrong fit, it's the wrong fit. So be happy. Move on with that in there. All right. So email and the engagement. I love the idea of the prize. What about and taking something, image or something? Is there anything cautionary we should be tuned into that we, if it's your own picture or caption and asking for a caption, that, you know, you're in safe territory? But what about when you pull other images or something else, Derek?
Yeah, this is great. And I like to err on the side of caution. So a lot of times I'm not sharing images in emails. One reason is even just more images and emails can potentially send something to spam. So that's one thing. It's not to say not to ever use images. I just talked about using an image. It's just, you know, one point of consideration. Most of my emails don't have an image. If I do have an image, I personally tend to avoid things that are like maybe things from movies or popular things like that for copyright purposes. That said, I'm not a lawyer. There is such a thing as fair use, where if you're making commentary on something, you can take quotes or extracts from things. A lot of times memes and things that are satire, but I'm not going to give legal advice. I would say I personally tend to err on the side of caution. And if you have questions, there are certainly, you know, you'd want to go to a proper lawyer who can guide you on that. I will say that you're in pretty safe territory if you link out to other things. Sometimes I'll leverage content by linking to a YouTube video and then making some comments on it. So just linking to someone's YouTube thing, or let's, you know, use Seth Godin as an example. Maybe you really like something Seth Godin said. You know, I might take a short little quote and be like, I read this great article. Here's a quote from it. Here's my thoughts. And here's a link to the article so people can actually go to the original source material. So I'm always crediting source whenever I know the source of something. I might take only just a short little extract and make some commentary on it, which can often fall under fair use. If I want, I'll link out to something. Some people have asked me, hey, Derek, can I basically copy and paste exactly what you wrote in this email? And I'm like, thanks for asking for permission, first of all. And yeah, as long as you give me credit, right? So a lot of times you can just reach out to someone. People have asked me if they could share my content. You know, it's not always going to be a yes, but a lot of times I'm like, yeah, sure, you can take my newsletter and post it on your blog. Just, you know, link back to my, give me credit, link back to my website, and we're all good. And that's the way to do it. If you're not sure, you can always ask someone for permission if you want to repost something or like actually copy and paste it, or you can just link out to whatever someone has created.
I love to do the link down. I remember one time, Derek, I I got, you know, it was one of these wee mornings when I was up at 3:30 or 4 or something. And I, something came across and it was a, it was like a 2-minute video with some on iPhones. It had iPhones and it had that, you know, the dominoing thing, like a wall going in and they go every which way and all that. And I was fascinated with watching that. And what I came, I ended up writing an entire blog around it on creativity. Where does it come from? You know, and I was wondering, you know, where in the hell did they get all these iPhones? 2, who had the time to set this up? And 3, who created the roadmap to do it? You know, I was just, you know, it was all about, whoa, this was amazing. But it comes from something. So it was the trigger. So I referred back to it. I gave everyone the link to go watch it. Because it's, and also, this is what I've learned. If I'm using videos and pushing something out, just special that I think is just amazing, that I will tell people this is a 2-minute video, this is 90 seconds, this is 5 minutes, just so they know. Because I don't know if you do, I get a lot of stuff, people say watch this, and I don't have 30 minutes to watch something, but I could find 2 minutes. Do you ever have those experiences?
Yeah, that could be a really useful thing to, if you want someone to watch it, letting them know, hey, check out this 3-minute and 27-second video, like literally saying that, because that can, especially if you're talking email, getting people to click through to it. If it's a shorter video or a shorter piece of content, that can entice people to click, because, you know, again, it's like if I look at something and even if it says it's 15 minutes, I have to go, do I want to take 15 minutes of my life to do this? But if it's 2 minutes, that's kind of a, oh, I got, you know, 2 minutes right now. I can check this thing out. So that's one thing you can do. And you also mentioned a blog and writing a blog article about what you saw. And mm-hmm. That's a cool thing with things like YouTube videos. A lot of times if you have, you're able to embed it, assuming that's how the creator set it up. So if you have a blog or website, sometimes your email could be a, you know, short and sweet email, links to your blog might have a video embedded in it. And then you have, you know, your commentary on it. So that way they can stay on your website, watch the video, if that's what it is, and then, you know, read your blog article about it. So there's a number of different strategies. And then again, with email, since we're talking about that, there are times where I just link out to a YouTube video or link out to an article or something, and then I'll put a little commentary in the email, or even sometimes it's just a real simple, here's a cool thing, here's why I like it. Talking about getting people to click through, giving them the benefit of watching it. Sometimes the benefit is, it's a hilarious video, it made me laugh, you know. So if you got 30 seconds, really funny video, that might brighten your day. And that might be all it takes. And then even if it doesn't have something to do necessarily directly with your topic, again, keep in mind, if you're an entertainer and people go, I really like, you know, every time I open one of Judas' email, I get a smile, or I feel good, or I feel uplifted, or I feel some sort of positive emotion. That is the biggest thing, because now they're connecting a positive experience with you and your emails. That's the goal that we're after.
And that is the goal. It's always about engagement. And sometimes it's a stealth engagement. Sometimes people will respond back. I found in the earlier days, people did respond much more often. Derek, do you see anything change? I mean, they just assume that it's going to have the content they're looking for. That's my experience right now. Am I off base here?
So it's the question about the engagement levels. Yeah. Have they gone? Are they not as high as they used to be?
Well, they could be engaging, but it could be mental engagement. It used to be like a lot of times people would have their ongoing blogs with commentary coming up. Mm. And that was very, very normal to see a whole bunch of commentary come in. I don't see it now. I actually see people who will read my blog, and instead of doing the commentary where they can do it, they will personally email me instead.
Yeah, so I haven't kept up with the blogging world quite as much. So I do think, though, that blog is really like anything. When blogs were more of a novel thing, or more of a, you know, when people were less inundated with content from all kinds of sources, then you're more likely to see the comments on the blogs. So I would say that, overall things may have gone down in the blogging world from a commentary standpoint. But as you see, people might still be reading it. And this is also a thing, whether it's with email, blogs, social media, just because someone's not commenting on it doesn't mean people aren't seeing it or engaging with it. And if you, I imagine, Judith, you probably have this experience. For anyone who hasn't had the experience, there's times where even on social media, I've had, I remember a high school reunion years ago, and I went there and people will be like, oh yeah, I've been seeing your posts on, you know, whatever, all your workout videos or whatever. And I was like, really? I haven't talked to you in years. I've never seen you like or comment or anything on it, but people are watching. And same thing can happen with emails. I might get an email and someone's like, yeah, I've been reading your emails for months or a year, and you know, I love what you're doing. But that might be the first time you hear from someone. So people could be liking what you're doing. They could be reading your blogs, watching your videos, checking out your social media. And you can't always go by the actual likes and comments or the actual responses. You might be impacting a lot more people. In fact, there are probably much more majority of people who aren't necessarily saying something to you or engaging directly with you. But yet they're still having some sort of internal mental, emotional response to your content. And that's the kind of thing. For every one person who sends an email to you that says, oh, I love what you wrote, or I love what you said here, there could be another 10 people who love it, but you just don't necessarily hear from them.
And Derek, you are absolutely so right on. You probably, all of you who are doing any kind of email, blogging, fill in the blank, because, you know, our blog actually goes out by an email once we have it up, that it's a new one and then title of it. And that I, out of the blue, I got a email and then a phone call from someone who had met me on a cruise 3 years ago, Derek, on a cruise down in the healthcare area. She fell and she hurt her arm or something. And she has been following me all of this time. She said, you're so kind, you know, when we met and I just remembered you and I followed you. And now my daughter is writing a book and can you help her? So you never know. You just never know what's out there.
Yeah, you never know. And this is why it's about the long-term relationship. This is a business principle, marketing principle, certainly an email thing. It's not necessarily about the quick fix, get them on the email list and immediately sell them. The great thing about email and all these other platforms is you start that relationship, you can nurture it, you can stay top of mind for months, sometimes years at a time. And when the person is ready, something in their life, or they know someone who's interested in your work, that's when they reach out. And because you've been nurturing this relationship, you're the person they think of when they're ready to buy your book or your services.
All right, we're going to be right back with Derek's final thoughts on expanding and building your email list in our last segment.
This is your guide to book publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask. With your host, Dr. Judith Briles. And we'll be right back with more great information right after these.
The book shepherding concept is simple. The publishing world is changing, and so must you. You need an experienced shepherd and guide to collaborate with you as you create, strategize, develop, publish, and achieve your publishing goals. Publishing is riddled with obstacles, sometimes nightmares for the author. You do not need more problems. You want solutions. Dr. Judith Briles will shepherd you through the maze and chaos. At times, she has had to step in and rescue a book. A book that has been sabotaged by a publisher, by a publishing service provider, and sometimes even by the author. If you want author and book success, connect with her today at thebookshepherd.com.
Welcome back to your guide to book publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask. If you want to write and publish a book, if you want to be successful as an author, your guide to book publishing, everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask, is for you. Stay tuned and you'll hear about statistics, scenarios, and strategies on what to do now to get you published. So let's get back to the show. And here again is your host, Dr. Judith Briles.
With me is Derek Doepker in this last segment. And we're really talking about the power literally the power of emails and why you want to start the gathering of them, building up, and you start building a relationship, even if you don't have a book in hand. You're just starting. You have a theme. You have an idea. You've got an expertise. You could be the ultimate storyteller of you know, fantasy. Who knows? But you can start building and sharing little tidbits as you're in your writer's walk going forward. So, Derek, we've got a few minutes here. Maybe we should go over and do. You've thrown a lot out that we can get it into a recap format and any other tidbits you'd like to add on.
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things we haven't really dived into on this session, which I imagine someone out there is going, well, this is all great, but what if I don't have an email list? How do I actually build my email list? And I'll refer back to the other interview we did, which is on the Aspire method. And so everything you talked about in that podcast relates to actually building your email list. So using ads to build your email list, social media, getting on platforms like guest podcasting, so on and so forth. So that's just a side note, like all the marketing methods are there to build the email list, and then having a compelling reader magnet, as Nick Stevenson calls it, or something that people are actually going to want to sign up for. So there's whole, you know, other trainings out there. Nick Stevenson's Reader Magnet books, I actually think, is free. But if you check out one big thing that I want to mention here is, if you're not sure what to offer your audience, and or you're not even sure what to email your audience, this is often a sign of not seeing good examples in real life or not having good role models, so to speak. And the thing is, if you're on other people's email lists, authors in your genre, outside of your genre, even people who aren't authors, and you're on people who actually deliver good emails, like engaging emails and newsletters, that will often give you inspiration. So earlier, I just mentioned the idea of having like a caption or, you know, cartoons or things like this. And, you know, that can give you ideas, even if you don't do the exact same thing, which I don't recommend, you know, copying exactly what someone else said, you can be inspired by it. So if you're ever stuck, a lot of times I go, you know, how many great email lists are you on? And a lot of people, they might be on a lot of email lists, but they're more on an email list that they don't enjoy getting versus emails that they do enjoy getting. So I would recommend seeking out role model examples of people who are good at email marketing, who have engaging emails, and that will help you see examples of offers that they create that can inspire you to get people to sign up, as well as the actual content that they send. So that's one thing. Make sure you have your source of inspiration. Right? It's like I'm a musician. So if I want to be inspired to write a song, I'm going to listen to other musicians. If I want to learn how to write rock music, I got to listen to other rock music or jazz music or whatever it is. Like, you need the source of inspiration. Then to recap, you have your mindset, which is an attitude of what is something that transcends only being an author. So you're an author and you're also an entertainer, a storyteller, an educator, a curator, any one or more of these identities, whatever works for you, because that will give you more ideas for content that you can share. When it comes to the content, another important mindset piece is this idea that it's taken me time to appreciate this. I still am surprised by it. And that is something that you might take for granted. You know, you might think this is just an ordinary thing, could be really engaging to someone else. So I'll give a couple examples. One could be seeing authors like posting pictures, and this can be done on social media. Like, here's my writing space. Or I saw, I think it was Alessandra Torre had like a picture of her, like how she was outlining a novel or things like that. And sometimes as authors, we go, oh, this is just part of my process. It's not a big deal. But to other people, they're like, that's really cool, or that's fascinating, or I love seeing kind of inside your world a little bit. So keeping in mind that something that seems really ordinary to you could be, it's brand new to people who aren't you, who don't know what your writing space is like, or your writing process, or the research that went into your novel, or how you're visiting this museum and you'd snap a picture and how that inspired something in your story, right? So keep in mind, you might, things that you maybe just think are ordinary parts of your life could actually be really engaging to other people. Another example for me is a real practical thing I do is I have a notepad in Evernote where I keep track of whenever I get reviews or testimonials that someone emails me or sends me for a book, I keep it in a document. So I have a particular, you know, title, book title, testimonials, and I just keep it all in a document. So whenever I'm writing an email or a post, I kind of have a whole document that I can go to and I can copy and paste any reviews or testimonials out of that. Now, to me, that's just a very ordinary thing that I do. And I mentioned that to an author. He thought it was a cool idea. So I sent an email about it and I get all these responses like, oh, that's a great idea, this or that. And I'm like, I didn't even, like, it was a non thing for me because it was just an ordinary part of my routine. But for someone else, I'm always reminded that's something new or interesting to someone who's not already doing that. So you might have things that you can teach or that you can share or part of your life or your process that are way more fascinating to other people. And it's important not to project your own, let's say, biases or feelings. You got to kind of get that out of the way sometimes when considering what's going to be engaging for other people.
Yeah, and you know, that you could even do it where other people, like, one of the things I always love to share that Ernest Hemingway actually sharpened 37 pencils before he sat down and wrote every day, and even though he wrote with a typewriter. But that was his, you know, like a dog circling before they lay down, you know, circle, 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 and then they lay down. That was part of his lay down. So what is your lay down, everyone? You know, I can tell you one of my reveals is I always have a big mug of hot tea at my side, always. And, you know, one of my, and some people know who, and I write that one of my rewards is I reveal that I gained 10 pounds doing that. But I had a bag of M&Ms I got every time I filled a chapter, you know, finished a chapter. I mean, the little things that opened you up. Opened you up as a person, and people love that. They love that.
Yeah, they love it. And you know, I'm a hardcore introvert. I'm not, you know, the type to naturally reveal a lot about, you know, here's what I had for dinner last night. Like, I, you know, so if anyone can relate, it's like I'm in the same boat. So a lot of this is appreciating that, you know, some of that are things that, you know, other people find entertaining, and also realizing that, you know, the reveals don't always have to be like these big personal things. It could be a simple thing like how you reward yourself with M&Ms for, you know, finishing a chapter. And then you can even create an engagement, which is, you know, asking people, you know, how do you reward yourself for a job well done? You know, people can send in the, you know, so even if you're not talking to other writers, you know, you universalize it. Which is the idea of, you know, if you're talking to writers, you can say, how do you reward yourself for writing? But if you're just talking to anyone, you go, that's how I reward myself after, you know, getting work done for the day. How do you, you know, do you have anything that you do to reward yourself whenever you've, you know, achieved a goal or gotten something done? Now you've taken it to something that anyone who does that has some sort of reward for themselves can do, right? So you're now doing a reveal. You're also potentially getting engagement if you do that. Another thing I really like that you can do for your emails and for content anywhere are rants and raves. You know, what bothers you and what do you love? And rants, you know, you can say maybe be a little careful with this. You don't want to be overly, let's say, negative necessarily, and that's unless that's your style. The thing is, though, like, if you, let's say it's a romance author, one of my clients, she's a romance author, and she can kind of rant about like these really weak heroines in stories and how she didn't like that. And that's one of the reasons she was inspired to write these strong heroines in her romance stories. So she can kind of rant about what she didn't like in the genre. And then people can relate to that. They're like, yeah, I'm with you. And it also gives in a bit of the why she's an author, why she writes in this genre. And it's touching even on a level of values, personal values. So think about things that you love, think about things that maybe bother you, and you can do it in a fun way. You can do it in an engaging way, and that can also give you content, because part of engagement is about emotional impact, right? So that's, you know, some of the big ideas there. You know, thinking about content, get inspiration, adopt the mindset of, you know, you're an educator, entertainer, storyteller, whatever identity serves you. And if you're ever stuck, I recommend, again, just be following other people who are good at this content thing, email or otherwise, other sources of content. And, you know, you can often get inspired by what you're seeing other people doing.
And inspired, and you actually have a stealth kind of mentor. You can, it's working for them. You make a decision, oh, I can do this. I mean, everyone, you all do realize that what may work for Derek or what may work for me may not be the fit for you. But there is something out there that you can do. And you're going to have to do some of your searching to see who, you know, who is doing things the way you would like to do it that you're comfortable with. And I think, Derek, that's an important word to understand. You have to be comfortable doing what you're doing.
Yeah, comfortable. And I would even say having fun with it is a good sign.
Yes.
Fun. If you're having fun, if it's like if it puts a smile on your face as you're creating it, then it's probably going to be putting a smile on other people's face. So that's a good litmus test. Not to say business is always, you know, that there's never a time that you got to challenge yourself and do the, you know, disciplined work of sitting down when you don't always in writing, when you don't always feel like it. Still, I'd argue a lot of times fun can be a great sign you're in the right direction. And if it's just feels too much like a chore, consider what if there was a fun way to do this? What would be fun? And a lot of times that'll make it more enjoyable for you, then also practically more enjoyable for your audience who's consuming the content.
Mm-hmm. And also, I love the idea that you're talking about in building that personal connection is do some of the revealing about your space where you work in and what you do or some of the things that you love. Like I'm a foodie and I've had more people say, you know, we know you're a foodie. So what are you cooking? What have you played around with and made up and share it with us? And I'll do that every once in a while.
Yeah. And it's funny. It's not always about your book's topic. Sometimes it's more about connecting human to human first and then understanding that the sales can come as a byproduct of that. And it's funny, you know, people knowing you're a foodie and relating to that, that could be the thing that makes them remember you and know, like, and trust you that ultimately leads to sales.
And that will do it. All right, Derek, thank you so much for being with us again this week. And everyone, Derek was on the Publishing at Sea Cruise, and he will be on the one next year, January 21st. If you want information on that, go to publishingatsea.com. We're starting to build the site again.
Thank you for being a part of Your Guide to Book Publishing. Everything you want to know but didn't know what to ask. With your host, Dr. Judith Bryle.